Very good evening, all of you. On behalf of Association of Indian Management Schools, I formally invite all the participants to this very, very special webinar. This is the 9th webinar session that we are organizing on behalf of Association of Indian Management Schools. Today's session is unique as well as different from the regular webinars. The topic itself is very, very contextual, and the title of the topic is Sustainability Management. Friends, we all know that over a period of time, almost for the last 70-75 years, India adopted the Western model for its development. Similarly, the most of the Western countries too followed a particular method that is always try to improve the performance in terms of profit. Most of the companies, most of the organizations, whether it is a manufacturing or service or trade, they all try to improve their performance in terms of earning the profits at the cost of society and nature. But after independence, India also adapted similar practice. Now, a period of 75 years of its development model, we have been experiencing turbulent times from now and then, maybe because certain issues, because of man-made, and many are nature-made. In fact, Indians, our Indian system, believed that there should be a sustainable relationship between human beings, society, and the nature. If there is a balanced relationship between the human beings, society, and nature, that gives place to each and every element, each and every living being and creature to live comfortably on this particular earth. Unfortunately, we missed that link and we adapted a different developmental models, and we have been experiencing lot of challenges in front of us. Why experiencing such a turbulent times, the entire world has come to the standstill situation with the corona virus or COVID-19. At this stage, time has come for the entire world to relook at the development model, relook at various strategies and approaches that we have been adopting to realize the goals of the world, where masses will have better benefits than few people. That's what Gandhiji also believed, that it is not mass production by masses, and decentralized system, that should be the development model. That's what Mahatma Gandhi said long back. Now the time has come, or maybe we have to thank the corona virus, and it has helped us or forced us to realize what should be the development approach now. At this juncture, sustainability management is one of the important alternative or better alternative that is available before us. On this particular topic, to discuss, we have with us the very, very eminent personality, Mr. K. Vinay Kumar. Mr. Vinay Kumar did his master's program from IIM Ahmedabad in the year 1992. After that, he has been working with many national and international organizations. Initially, he involved in a number of exciting projects, particularly restructuring companies with a number of organizations like Wiltech, HMB, CET, Glass Fiber Division, CRLE India, and RICO, etc. He worked with Ernst & Young International in their consultancy division, where he had the opportunity of working with a wide range of companies in a number of different fields, including healthcare, telecommunication, information technology, petrochemicals, retail sector, etc., particularly in their corporate strategy and planning. Very interestingly, he worked with NetJets Inc., owned by Warren Buffett, the largest organization, where he owns 1,500 aircrafts. He was involved in performance improvement activities of that particular company and was also closely involved with the corporate strategy, planning, and process improvement. And after returning to India, Mr. Vinay Kumar joined Apollo Hospitals Group in Hyderabad, where he was responsible for a number of functional areas, including international business development, service quality, developing internal systems and controls, human resource planning, and financial planning too. He was also with Vasant Skypes Limited as CEO, a part of Vasant Group, where the Vasant Group is one of the largest medical transcription companies in India and the first BPO company in India. And he has been an active participant in various national and international forums as an expert speaker. He was also the member of VJIIM Hyderabad, Board of Studies member of Management Studies River University. He was also the expert visiting faculty with various management institutions like Narasimhanji, Indian School of Business, IIMs. Is currently an adjunct faculty member at Indian Institute of Management, Kozhikode. And he is the first person who started the data analytics company in India. So many data analytics companies have come in the recent past. He is the pioneer in establishing Datawise company, and he is acting as the CEO, where the organization is actively engaged in consulting, research, and analytics. And getting him and fixing him for the webinar itself was the toughest task. He was so busy with the national and international organizations. Again, he has to join the international conversation at 7 o'clock in the evening, where he has his own three offices in America, where he has to interact with his employees there. So with great difficulty, he has accepted our invitation, because he has a passion to the teaching and sharing little knowledge with the academicians. Sir, Mr. Vinay Kumar, I welcome you to this particular ninth webinar that we are organizing on behalf of Association of Indian Management Schools. Now, most of the participants are also from with the management and other backgrounds. I'll be happy if you can share your ideas on sustainability management in this toughest situation where the world is moving. Now, I request Mr. Vinay Kumar, please take the platform and initiate the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Narayan Reddy, for the kind introduction. I hope I am audible to all of you. The job of an entrepreneur is to smell an opportunity before it is visible to others. So when Professor Narayan Reddy talked about data analytics, he is very right. I thought about data analytics way back in 2003, when people were still not even aware of what data analytics is. Likewise, 2 years ago, I started thinking about the world that we live in. And I thought that the way we are consuming our resources, we are probably going to exhaust them faster than what we have available. And that is where I came up with this entire idea of sustainable growth. And I started my second company called Eternal Green, which is into ensuring sustainable and green businesses. The moment we hear about sustainability to our mind, the typical images which come are of social activists, people who are protesting about climate change, but that is not the only opportunity. From a business environment perspective, there is a very big opportunity available for those who are willing to look at the business aspects of it. You will be surprised to know that today, the global carbon trading market is seen to be about $215 billion. That is the size of the market, which means really people who are getting in early in this game are likely to see a very, very huge benefit in the coming years. Even the Indian government has started the legal framework for carbon trade registry, and it is likely that the carbon trade registry will become a reality within the next in a very short period of time. So really we are moving into a regime where people are becoming much more conscious about this sustainability management as the new world. As Professor Narayan Reddy correctly said, COVID-19 has given us all a moment to pause and think about what direction are we headed in. In many instances, we are forced to revisit our old and traditional methods of doing things. For example, as we were discussing just a couple of days ago, washing of hands and feet before you enter the house has now again become the norm, which was the norm so many years ago in India. But people ignored it. People thought that we could do away with it. And suddenly we realized that we are forced to revisit that world. The other big news, which I think lots of people are seeing in the papers suddenly, is that the environment is getting cleaner, temperatures are getting cooler, birds are again coming out. So suddenly we are getting back to normal nature. And that's a lesson for all of us to learn about how unsustainable we have made our world in the past so many years. And this 30 or 40 day break is teaching us that there is a method to get back to from our madness to a more sustainable and equitable method of ensuring growth. Having said that as a beginning, one of the core things which I believe management schools have left out of their curriculum over the past few years is an emphasis on sustainability management. Today, while I've spoken about the market which has come out because of carbon credits, there is also a larger emphasis on ISO standards which have been developed specifically for application to sustainability management, which means corporate world is now very clearly moving towards that side. Therefore, it becomes imperative for management schools to reintroduce the subject of sustainability management so that when the students graduate, they have an idea of what it would entail and then look for the kind of opportunities which arise because of the emergence of this new field. Very quickly, I will walk through slides, and this is a very high level presentation, but I will request all of you, if you have questions, please keep those questions and I'll be happy to answer them towards the end of our session. The big question is, why is sustainability management suddenly becoming so relevant? It is not relevant today. In fact, the very first report on sustainability of the world was produced by the Limits to Growth report in 1972, which talked about the available natural resources in the world getting exhausted within one or two generations. We are already one generation away from that today. So in essence, we are talking about one more generation by which time we would have consumed a significant amount of our resources which were available to us. And therefore, this entire definition of what sustainable development is all about was coined as early as 1987, which said that development which meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So our current greed cannot be at the expense of future generations' need. And that's a very critical point to note. Today, already in many parts of the world, people are talking about scarcity of water resources. In South Africa, last year, for example, there was a reverse countdown which started because they expected that availability of potable water for the purposes of drinking in Johannesburg would no longer be available. And therefore, the city would become difficult to live in just because water is not available as a resource. When and I'm talking about even 30, 40 years ago, nobody even assumed water to be a scarce resource. But today, even water is becoming a scarce resource. Likewise, there are so many other resources which are considered to be available in plenty. In Delhi, today we talk about pollution, and pollution has become one of the biggest hazards in a city like Delhi. And these are all developments because development has happened without taking into consideration the sustainability of such developments. I'm sure all of you saw the news yesterday, which was a very tragic day, especially for people who are from Andhra Pradesh. There was a major accident which happened in Vizag, where a polymers factory leakage caused death to a lot of people, and also a lot of people have been hospitalized. And I am not too sure how many of you are aware. Immediately, the government rose to the occasion and granted about 1 crore to the families of those who died, and another other amounts to people who were hospitalized. The question which arises is, was that development at the expense of human cost? And is that a acceptable cost for the kind of development which has happened? And even if it was an acceptable cost, is that compensation agreeable for the loss to humanity in terms of livelihood? And these are all very relevant questions. We have been forced to revisit these questions after 1984, when the Bhopal gas tragedy happened, again yesterday, because again we are seeing a recurrence of something like this. It could have been because of negligence of an individual. It could have been because of negligence or in following certain SOPs, or it could have been sheer greed for generating profit without consideration to human lives. And these are all very relevant questions which need to be addressed. I am sure there is going to be a lot of litigation. I am sure there are going to be a lot of heartburns, a lot of money which will have to be paid up by the corporate world because of what happened yesterday. But I can assure you, these kind of global disasters have become the norm worldwide. Perhaps in India, we are still not seeing it as much as it's already happening in some other countries. Global oil spills have become so common, and compensations are being demanded against such global oil spills. Companies like Shell, which were once upon a time known to be the biggest pollutants, have completely changed their direction to now become a sustainable organization. So organizations are also alive to the problems which are out there. In this context, therefore, sustainability management has become very, very relevant today. Why sustainability? As a world today, we are facing six complex global environment issues. Biodiversity, there's a significant reduction in biodiversity today. Climate change, we are already talking about melting of the polar glaciers. Rising of sea levels, international waters which are again getting polluted, because of which there is sea lives which are no longer available, land degradation, ozone layer depletions, and persistent organic pollutions. Today we speak about cows which are outside roaming on the streets, and when they die, they find that there are plastics inside the intestines of the cows. So those are all coming from human creations. We have created an environment where plastics have become so prevalent that we are unable to live without it. Of course, the government is taking steps to slowly wean us away from use of plastics, to single-use plastics, to completely doing away with plastics. But all of this has become a real problem today. So what exactly are our constraints under which we operate? If you really look at what is happening to nature, climate is changing, cropland is diminishing, fisheries are collapsing, forests are shrinking, species are getting extinct, minerals are being depleted, pollution is increasing, rivers are running dry, sea level is rising. So you see a whole lot of changes which are happening to nature, and on the other hand, human society population is increasing, resources are decreasing, resource wealth per person is decreasing. So what is really happening? While the rich are one third are exploiting the resources for profit, for the rest it has become a fight for survival. So there is this big disparity between limited resources availability and a fight for maximization of the benefits out of those available resources. So really, what are we talking about? If you really look at what is happening today, and we are at that cusp today, in the early 1960s to 1980s, we were still at a stage, we were not using our resources to the extent that they were available. But since the early 1990s, and more so now in the current decade, our ecological debt, which means the amount that we are consuming, is overshooting the amount of supply which is out there. And if our consumption keeps overshooting the supply, a time will come when this will become completely sustainable. So what do we need to do in this current state? It is unsustainable to continue to consume resources unless we flatten the curve. Flattening the curve has become a very common word nowadays, because in COVID-19, we are all talking about how to flatten the curve. The flattening of the curve is required in terms of reducing our ecological footprint so that our rate of consumption is less than what is the available resources on planet Earth. So what is driving this entire move towards sustainable businesses? One is there is a high degree of consciousness among the consumers today. In fact, lots of consumers are now coming and demanding that we want an eco-friendly product. So when it comes to purchasing air conditioners, for example, we are talking about five-star air conditioners. Five-star air conditioners means they use less of pollutants for the kind of energy for the kind of AC that is being cooling that is being produced. Just as an example. So consumers are demanding that. Today there is a complete push towards electric cars, moving away from diesel or petrol cars. That push is coming from the consumer side, because consumers are saying, we don't want to use diesel or petrol because that is going to increase pollution within the environment. So that push is coming from the consumer side. The second push is coming from the technology side. With the availability of technology, we are able to do much more by spending less. For example, in many cases today, paper is becoming redundant. We don't need to use paper anymore for a lot of form filling. Forms can now be done using technology. most of our work, which was being done earlier with pen and paper, is now being done without pen and paper. Today, invoices are being sent by businesses on electronically. Payments are being received electronically. We are getting into a world which will hopefully at some point of time become paperless. Many of the Scandinavian countries today are already in a economy where notes, currency notes, are not being used anymore. So that is the state to which technology has moved, where we are getting into lesser consumption of resources. Public regulations are also playing their own active role. In Europe, for example, no flights are permitted after 10 o'clock at night. And that is a regulatory requirement, because they want to ensure that people do not get noise pollution at night time when they're supposed to be sleeping. Now, we are still a long way away from that in India, but I think the whole world is going to move towards that. And then there is a lot of social activism which is happening worldwide. I think we are all quite familiar with the angry young girl who became the, the person everybody started commenting on when it came to environment consciousness. So that again is, fortunately, the younger generation is becoming much more active in looking at environment and what aspects of environment need to be protected. And of course, then there is social justice to be talked about. Change towards corporate citizenship. Corporates are becoming much more conscious of their role towards the society and what is it that they need to do, not just provide employment. They're looking at a much more holistic view of who are their stakeholders. So if you look at some of the companies such as Hindustan Zinc or Sterlite, most of these companies today which are starting new industries or new factories in new places, they're also taking steps to ensure that people in the vicinity are being either provided livelihood or they are being taken care of in other ways to bring up their social development itself. So that corporate citizenship has been a big push. Along with that, of course, there has been a government regulation also to say that companies beyond a certain turnover need to set aside some amount of money for CSR activities, which means that money is being driven towards making some of these sustainable initiatives happen. And of course, then there is process innovation to talk about. So there are a whole lot of drivers which are making sustainable business happen today. How do we talk about sustainable development? And this is a very well-known framework. It is called the triple bottom line approach, which means not only are we supposed to look at the economic aspects, we are also supposed to equally worry about the social aspects and the environmental aspects. And when we talk about economy, we are obviously talking about what do we do to facilitate resources to be used in an efficient and responsible way, either using innovation to improve prosperity, to increase productivity. When it comes to social, we are talking about what goals, what practices do we have to ensure that poverty is reduced, community health is improved, wellness is improved, and human rights are protected. And when it comes to environment, we are talking about what practices or decisions are being taken to mitigate climate change, improve land use, and increase biodiversity or protect biodiversity. So this is called a triple bottom line approach. And most companies, especially large multinationals all over the world today, have taken an approach to ensure that they are meeting this triple bottom line approach for sustainability. Of course, when we talk about sustainability, we cannot forget the UN goals for sustainability development, which is called the SDGs. In various formats, all countries are following these goals, because there is a clear need to ensure that these goals are being achieved. In India, the government has formulated something called the Sustainability Development Framework, or the SDF, which takes a lot of these initiatives and has created a framework. We are working very closely with the mining companies today in India, where star ratings are being given to companies based on it's a five-star company if they're meeting a lot of the goals, four-star company if they're meeting lesser goals, and so on and so forth. And the government has got a goal to ensure that all the mines in India become a five-star mine in a given time frame. So there is a huge amount of push which is happening to ensure that each of these goals are being met. I'm not going to go into the details of this because this is an exhaustive chapter by itself, but I wanted to at least sensitize everybody to what is happening on the SDGs. And the SDGs have got a timeline of up to 2030, by which time most countries in the world are expected to achieve certain parameters on these goals. And we'll talk about those parameters also. These are the indicators which are typically being talked about when we talk about sustainability indicators. There are a total of 27 indicators, and each of those indicators has again got subsets to it, which gives you the total list of what all indicators are being used to measure sustainability. Obviously, greenhouse gas emissions is the highest ranked among all of them, because the amount of pollution that we are creating, it has got multiple ripple effects, right from increasing the pollution to reducing human life or human health and therefore human productivity. So it has got multiple effects to that, and going right to the bottom of forest area and its utilization, because ultimately if you are reducing forest area to a large extent, you are reducing the availability of oxygen or clean air for us to breathe. So all of that comes into sustainability indicators. In the current context of disaster reduction, which is where we are today with COVID-19, there are seven global targets which have been set in the Sendai framework. And those seven global targets relate to mortality, affected people, economic loss, damage to critical infrastructure, and disruption of basic services. And all of these need to be reduced. And there's a target to reduce them. And then some things have to be increased. What has to be increased is countries with national and local DRR strategies has to increase. International cooperation to developing countries has to increase. Availability and access to multi-hazard early warning systems and disaster risk information and assessment has to increase. If you really look at the context of COVID-19 today, there is one positive and one negative lesson to learn. The negative lesson to learn is that had China intimated the rest of the world early enough about the seriousness of the pandemic, perhaps we could have avoided the current stage in which we are all there. And that is a lack of cooperation between developing countries. But the silver lining today is that Gilead, which is now developing the first antidote to the virus, has agreed to give this at a nominal cost to all the countries across the world. And that is a classic case of international cooperation to mitigate this kind of risk. I think in the world going forward, we'll see more and more of these kind of disasters, and we'll see more and more of these kind of risk reduction, which is going to happen through global cooperation. I thought we should pause because there is a lot of confusion which keeps happening on three or four terms. Professor Reddy, you want to say something, then you can move on.
Okay, one or two questions and observations are also there. So let us know the observations and then proceed further with the presentation.
Sure.
Professor Pratap Reddy from Dhruva Management Institute, he just observed that is sustainability live one, let live policy. That's one. Second thing is Professor R.C. Bhattacharya from Calcutta Global Scene Business School mentioned that what about the population explosion? See, right now it is about 7 billion and it may become 9.5 by 2050. So, what should be done about this population explosion? Is one question which he raised. Similarly, one Mr. Nagendra from Rewa University, he just mentioned environmental dimension has taken utmost importance in the post 1987 Brundtland Commission report. However, what he says, whatever he says, social dimension is the most neglected issue in the entire process. So these are the few observations. So what would be your reaction?
I think these are excellent comments, all of them. The Brundtland report is a landmark report. So Professor Nagendra's comments are perfectly on the spot, because 1987 was a turning point in the way we viewed sustainable development. Absolutely right. On the question of live and let live, I think Dr. Pratap Reddy, live and let live is the minimum datum expected in sustainable development. It is not just about live and let live. It is about consideration for not only our generation, it is consideration for all future generations. So when we say live and let live, we typically think about only our generation. It goes much beyond that. It has to go to a level where we are talking about for the next 3,000 years. So it's almost like that. Was it Dr. Bhattacharya?
Bhattacharya from Globasim, Calcutta.
I think Dr. Malthus' exposition was made a long time back about population explosion. But there is an alternative theory which is, of course, coming through today. The alternative theory is that the TFR, which is the total fertility rate for the world, is beginning to stabilize. When I say beginning to stabilize, we are still not there. So 7 will not become 9.5, but 7 is definitely going to become 8. So what is considered to be a sustainable world population is going to be about 8 billion. And why I am confident about this is that whereas in countries such as India, we are still at a TFR of close to 2.2 to 2.3, which is for every two people, we are having 2.2 children on an average being produced. In countries such as Japan or countries, developing countries in Europe or USA, these numbers are currently below 1, which means the rate of growth is much below what will be sustained. So overall, we'll have about 8 billion population, and we need to prepare for that kind of a population.
Another small observation, name is not mentioned. See, most of the MNCs and the large corporations, they are trying to meet the mandatory conditions prescribed by the respective governments, but they have not taken the sustainability as a part and parcel of the decision-making system of these companies. That is a general observation by one participant.
That's a true observation in the Indian context today. But again, I'll take you back to the original point that I made. Once our carbon credit registry in India becomes active, you will see a very marked change in the way companies start to behave. Today, companies don't see their financial benefit immediately, but that is going to start coming in very soon.
Now, let us continue your presentation, sir. Afterwards, again, I will come back with some more observations.
So, this is a very simple slide I put together, because I know lots of people use the term jugaad, frugal, and sustainable interchangeably. They are not interchangeable. They are completely different terms, although there is some amount of overlap. So, jugaad is it's a clever improvisation. Something that you do simply because you are low on resources, but you want to achieve a certain goal. Mostly it is low tech, but also it is not necessarily sustainable. That is very important to understand. Jugaad is a quick fix. Jugaad is not a long-term fix. Frugal, on the other hand, is a much more longer-term fix. It's an innovation, but you do that because you have got limited resources and you want to ensure that you are getting to the same or similar level of product, which would be done without applying these methods. And sustainable, of course, we have spoken enough about sustainable right now. It is a much more holistic way of looking at things. You're not just looking at a product or a company. You're looking at a 360-degree view and looking at all the stakeholders and not just the shareholder for the purpose of benefiting.
Okay.
Okay, so that's very quick perspective I thought I should give before I move on to the next part of my presentation.
Yes.
One of the big things which is happening today is more and more companies are looking at sustainability assessment and management. In fact, every year NTPC, I know as an organization, does a sustainability assessment across its factories all over, across its plants all over India. And that is a mandated requirement for them. Why is sustainability assessment being done? And I'll just give you a simple example. To produce the amount of energy that NTPC produces, their biggest raw material after coal is water. And water is not an abundant resource. So the amount of water that evaporates at every power plant makes it long-term unsustainable. And I know because I had a long conversation with the managing director of NTPC, they need to keep buying water just to keep themselves going. And that becomes a very unsustainable method. So NTPC is at the forefront of trying to do sustainability assessment. Again, what all do you look at in that assessment and management? You look at a comprehensive system-based approach. So you look at alternative options, what all should be used, how do you include environment and economic consequences of any action or social consequences of any action, okay? What are the intergenerational aspects of the consequences? And then what are the stakeholder involvement and collaborations which are possible? And each of these three are a key component of sustainability assessment and management. This is a framework which is being used by EPA, which is the Environment Protection Agency in the USA. And I'm not saying this is what should apply to India, but it is a framework where they say how every decision on assessment should be made. And there's a particular stepwise process that has been given to say if you follow these steps, then perhaps your assessment of your sustainability assessment would be superior to what you do otherwise. We also have got a concentric sustainability framework where you are looking at aligning environmental capital to leadership capacities, right from environmental to social to economic to institutional to organizational to personal. Okay, because at the end of the day, every economic activity which is being done for personal goals and not for business goals. So how do we ensure that each of these are getting aligned? And this is a very nicely done sustainability framework, which is spoken about. Okay. Also from a UN perspective, there is a GRI, which has now become mandatory in most large companies. GRI is a global reporting initiative for sustainability, where reports are supposed to be produced by companies talking about their impact on economy, environment, and society. And very quickly, the content has to include stakeholder inclusiveness, sustainability context, materiality, completeness, and principles have to include accuracy, balance, clarity, comparability, reliability, timeliness. So to the question somebody asked, is it only lip service? Well, it cannot be lip service anymore because there is a certain norm by which you are supposed to report. So you cannot just copy paste from somebody else and say, this is my framework or this is what I'm doing. It is not going to work anymore because it is going to be held to a mirror to demonstrate whether you are meeting a certain standard of reporting or not. This is just one example I've given of how that framework can be drawn. This is an example taken from a healthcare company where they said that they're looking at various prioritizations depending on stakeholder involvement to say what should be done with each of the elements of which impact sustainability for them. A very quick word on assessment tools. And I am of the strong view that when a graduate is coming out of any of the good MBA schools, the minimum he should have is at least these tools to be able to go and represent himself in the business world. One obviously is the risk assessment tool. And there are lots of good risk assessment tools available. I think our students should be equipped with understanding at least some of the basic minimum tools of risk assessment. The second is life cycle assessment tools. We're especially talking about cradle to grave or cradle to grave, cradle kind of analysis, where you are looking right from the beginning of the supply chain process to the end of the supply chain process. The third one, which was very during my times, as Professor Narayan Reddy correctly said, it was very common to talk about SBCA, which is a social benefit cost analysis. I think somewhere during this entire rush for development, we have forgotten about this very basic analysis which should be done before any project is initiated. But I think it is time to revisit it, at least from a college perspective and for student perspective. And finally, we are talking about the sustainability impact assessment, because this has become a new form of consulting activity, which is being done by all the big four today, because this is being asked by most companies or by most governments. So there are lots of tools, but I thought at least these four basic tools need to be, students need to be made aware of these four basic tools when it comes to sustainability. Finally, I just wanted to give a few examples of what are the available frameworks which are being used by some of the companies. Sembcorp, which is one of the leading energy, marine and urban development group, has got its own framework which includes all these aspects of low carbon economy, to talking about empowering responsible business practices, to people and community initiatives. And each of them has been again further divided into specific goals which are supposed to be achieved in that framework. And a couple of examples closer to home, Aditya Birla Group has come out with its own framework, although I might not be completely in agreement with their framework, but at least they are talking about a sustainability framework. This is much more legal in nature rather than, holistic in nature. But they're talking about achieving a standard which is sustainable, which meets the needs of Sustainable World 2050. And similarly, Coal India has come out with its own standard for environment, social, cultural sustainability and economic sustainability. So broadly speaking, this is what I thought I should cover. And I'm kind of done. I'm happy to go deeper or take more questions, whichever way is correct.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Vinay Kumar. We have a few more observations as well as questions. Again, one question related to the population from Ramakrishnan Rajamani. He says, do you attribute natural resources depletion, such as water and increase in pollution, etc., to growth in population, or do you think literacy is an issue? Literacy versus growth in population, is the which one is the responsible for the natural resources depletion? That is one observation actually. And Dr. Durga Prasad from Vigyan Jyoti, most of us speak about sustainable development, but clear and stable implementation policy from the government is required. It is an observation from our Professor Durga Prasad. And one Professor Narasimha Rao from VR Siddhartha College, he says, are the government policies and law related to sustainability is effective in India? Is an effective versus ineffective issue as raised by Professor Narasimha Rao. And of course, Professor Pratap Reddy come back with one more question, that how non-cooperation between developing countries is reason for COVID-19 spread? Because when it's China, which never disclosed the emergence of virus in Wuhan for quite some time. So this is a critical observation from Professor Pratap Reddy ji. So any, and similarly, though Shell company is done better, but however, oil spill has become a factor as a nut in the good performance of Shell company. There's also one important exception factor. Population versus literacy is one issue that our friend has raised.
Okay, let me start with the population versus literacy. And I think that's a very, very, very well framed question. I don't know how many of you are familiar with our old days. In houses in our younger days, we were never told to throw water. Used water would always go back into the gardens to, you know, water our plants. Now we have got slightly more sophisticated. We talk about rainwater harvesting. But in a city like Bangalore, for example, today, no new complex is allowed without rainwater harvesting. So part of the change happens because of education. Part of the change happens because of regulation. But if you do not have these conditions, then the chances are that we will continue to deplete our resources. The question about population being a cause for depletion, I don't think they are related. Definitely, increasing population puts more pressure on available resources. But God has been kind to the world. God has actually given more resources than what we need. It is just that we are reckless about the way we use it, rather than being careful about the way we use it. So yes, education and regulation together would perhaps put us back on track. Could you just repeat the second question, Professor Reddy?
One interesting question is, no doubt we all, the policymakers and the experts in the respective field, recognized the sustainability, development and management is important. What about its inclusion in the part and parcel of the curriculum of education system? One observation has come like this. So what do you think that, what about incorporation of these issues in, as a part and parcel of or a compulsory subject, maybe at undergraduate level or postgraduate level?
Yeah, so I think what happens is at a school level, there is a consciousness which is built into the students. Up to class 10, at least when it comes to social sciences, they're spoken, I mean, environment is spoken about. But suddenly, once you come to the inter level or graduation level, the ball is dropped. And for right reasons, because all along, it was never seen to be a great business idea. Sustainability was never seen to be a business idea, but that has now changed. Therefore, it is now imperative to reintroduce the subject of sustainability in our curriculum. So yes, at an MBA level, I think it's extremely important to reintroduce that as a curriculum, perhaps as a 20 credit course, but it should be there. Even if it's optional, at least it should be introduced first. And then as the demand keeps increasing, because I know the big four today, practically all the big four have divisions which are catering to sustainability right now. So that becomes an opportunity, you know.
Another point, now with the COVID pandemic influence, now we have been without control, we have been exploiting the environment and people are also using and misusing the resources, etc. Do you think this COVID pandemic will be a lesson for the people and also the societies?
So there is a beauty, I'm not an expert on that, but there have been at least five or six people who have written some very nice articles on what is going to be the immediate, short-term and long-term impact of COVID-19 on behavioral changes.
Yes.
In the short run, and there is a very nice article called a low-touch economy. I think the whole world is moving towards what is called a low-touch economy, which means how do I reduce a human-to-human interaction while keeping business going? Mm. So that is one immediate fallout which will be visible, and it is already visible throughout the world. But in the longer run, one of the research that I have done myself is on the tourism and the airline industry. These industries are going to be the most severely impacted, not just for now, but for the medium term, because people will figure out methods to meet without physically meeting. The need for air travel will reduce. So that is going to be an impact which will be there. So COVID-19 is going to teach those lessons to the economy worldwide.
Yes, there were interesting question again it related to COVID. See, the sustainability differs from nation to nation, but COVID has made all the countries to realize at least that let us integrate local sustainability steps with the global sustainability factors simultaneously. That is one observation has come from Shavina. And how the political environment in different countries will affect the global sustainability. Of course, you have already touched some aspects of this particular thing. Actually. So now, do you think, do you think that local sustainable factors must get integrated with the global sustainable practices?
Yeah, so the silver lining for what is happening with COVID-19 today is that lesser developed countries are in a better position than more developed countries. And I'm saying it's a silver lining because more developed countries have always been using more resources than they require to sustain, always, consistently. So if you look at the energy consumption in the USA, energy consumption in USA is approximately 7 to 8 times energy consumption in India.
Yes.
So US has always been, I mean, the Western countries, the more developed countries have always been more unsustainable in their resource consumption than the lesser developed countries have been. So that's the silver lining for countries such as India, because the impact is going to be less significant on us than it's going to be on some of those countries. But the other fallout is,
there may be
just a very quick one. The other fallout is this entire principle of globalization is going to be reversed, at least in the short to medium term. Because from outsourcing to offshoring, it will now become nearshoring. So countries will start becoming more self-sustained rather than depending on other countries for their sustenance. So that's another big trend which is going to start happening.
Yes, and the small question, which is more of a technical question, has come. How valuation of ecosystem services can be used in the interest of sustainability managing human inhabited and natural landscapes? It is more of a technical aspect.
No, that's a perfect question. SCBA is a very well-known framework for measuring the value of it. So, I mean, from a financial perspective, we're all aware of the NPV method of valuation. SCB imputes a value to every one of the environmental or the social impact which a particular project or a particular company's business has. And that brings an imputed downgradation to value or an upgradation to value, depending on how it is done. I've given an answer at a very high level, but I'll be happy to elaborate in one-on-one conversation.
Okay. So I think that we have come to the time is running out. I would like to just briefly conclude the webinar. So at the outset, I am very much thankful to you, Professor Vinay Kumar, for your kind gesture and detailed presentation. Though this session is one hour, but we have covered many important aspects, particularly the concept of sustainability development and sustainability management, development models without considering certain basic issues. And you have also very rightly raised a point that recently the concern of the younger generation is showing a lot of interest for the social sustainability development. And similarly, the holistic view of development than just providing employment. This is very, very important because the most of the large companies, they always focus that they are providing large lot of employment opportunities, ignoring the holistic view in their mission and the vision. So this particular point is very, very valid in the present context. Similarly, the triple bottom line approach of sustainability is well taken point for the future generations. Similarly, Sendai framework for disaster risk management is very, very important lesson for most of us, that we have to take all these things into consideration and we must incorporate these approaches into the curriculum of management as well as general education system by carrying out all these things. And also the examples you have given, Coal India and the other Birla company and all the case studies, the entire focus that you have touched into the basic issues, and you covered the two things. On one side, you have focused on academic orientation. At the same time, you have also given the practical challenges and issues that the country and the world that it has it is facing. So with these two approaches, I am sure that our webinar will be a very, very fruitful session. I am sure that the participants would have really enjoyed the presentation given by you. And my basic concern is that our future generation should thank us rather than curse us for our indifferent attitude. See, absolutely, we must hand over this particular entire earth to our next generation, and they must carry this earth or environment into the next level. So if they have to be thankful to us, it is our responsibility to protect the environment and take the sustainable goals and implement the sustainable goals in the day-to-day life of the human beings individually, okay, the community at the group level, at a macro level, the society, and also at the global level. Once we take these things into consideration as a part and parcel of our day-to-day life, I am sure that, as Professor Pratap Reddy said, live and let live approach will make a lot of difference, and that should become a mass movement in the days to come. Once we become R1, it becomes a mass movement. I am sure that the challenges like COVID, which we have been experiencing, may not come in the days to come, and our next generation and future generations will be leading their life with more satisfaction. And I also expect that there will be a lot of behavioral change that is to be seen in the present and the future generations, so that as I mentioned in my earlier remarks, the cordial relation between and among human beings, society, and nature. If there is a perfect balance among these three important elements, I am sure that even the COVID-like experiences that may erupt in future, the world will be ready to face such a challenges. With these few introductory remarks, I once again thank you for being here as a guest speaker and sharing your valuable knowledge with our participants. And I also thank the participants who have been actively participated and also raised some very, very pertinent questions for the discussion. And I am sure that the participants also must have benefited. And of course, the subject is very, very vast and very, very macro in nature. Many more issues are there, but at least we have aims as a body, has tried its level best to give the brief background to the sustainability management practices. And I am sure that this session will be more fruitful and useful to all the participants. I am also requesting the participants, please take the note of these discussions, and in your circles, take these points very actively, so that you can also discharge your responsibility in spreading the sustainability goals that are there before all of us, set by UN also. With these few concluding remarks, I once again thank you for your sparing your time. And also I thank my head office and also office at Pune, who have made the infrastructure arrangement for this particular session, for their active arrangements. with these few things. And thank you very much. And again, there are 2-3 webinars lined up in the tomorrow and day after also. I request all the participants, please do.